Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.
If you've ever been involved with a legal matter, chances are you've dealt with a process server. The role of a process server is simple. He or she delivers legal documents to people involved in a legal proceeding. However, the job is rarely as easy as it sounds. Isaac Points joins Denver DA Mitch Morrissey to talk about process serving on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks, and this is Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, so great to see you. Happy New Year.
Good to see you. Good to see you, Tamara.
We have a really fun guest today. Who is he?
Yeah, we have a great guest. We have Isaac Points. Isaac Points actually is our process server at the DA's office. He's really the only contract worker that we have on our staff, but he serves process for us and has his own private company, so he serves process for a number of other people. Including, he used to serve for my father when my father was in private practice.
Wow.
So Isaac and I go way back. I actually served process when I was in law school, so I have some experience with what Isaac does, but there's nobody better in the state of Colorado and probably in the United States as getting the papers served to the people that we need them.
Well, Isaac, welcome, and we're good buddies, too. We go way back.
Oh, yes, you have never
had to process and serve me, but...
That's a good thing.
That's a good thing. So for folks who don't understand what that job is, tell us a little bit about what it involves.
Okay, most of the time, process serving is the first cog in the legal wheel that keeps the machine going. Like in most court actions or county or civil or criminal actions, a lot of times if they need to find someone as a witness or if someone that's being sued on a legal matter, the first step is usually to get somebody served the papers to show up in court, either on a legal matter like in a collection matter or on a criminal matter where it's a witness or a victim on a criminal case.
So you're basically telling them that they need to appear in court?
Yes. They need to show up to court. They need to show up on time. They need to be there.
Now, some people just get a notice in the mail. How is this different from, say, maybe a traffic ticket that you know it's got a date that you've got to show up in court if you want to fight the ticket?
Almost on a traffic matter, you know, if they don't show, the court will just enter a failure to appear on them, then they'll just eventually go and work it out. On a, people can serve a summons civilly, you know, registered mail, but it rarely ever gets done. And even in Mitch's office, the first step in a lot of the witnesses, they send them a friendly waiver signed by Mitch Morrissey. We would like you to show up to court on this date on this matter. Some people will fill out the card and mail it in. Yes, I'll be there willingly and voluntarily. And then on the bottom it says, yeah, failure to send this in, a process server may be knocking on your door to serve you. So and that's where I come in. I'm at the point where they... that's when I go and tell them, you know, they need to appear for this trial on this matter. If they've exhausted every attempt, you know, then they'll try calling the witness, say, you know, we didn't get your card. Are you still going to show? Yeah, but, you know.
You know, what really is important is I have investigators that Isaac works with. Mm-hmm. And we have certain kinds of cases where if we don't have personal service, we're not going to be able to proceed. So, for instance, in a lot of domestic violence cases, and Isaac is out there always looking for victims of domestic violence to serve because, you know, we're months after the incident, sometimes years after the incident, and oftentimes the victim has gone back a lot of times because she's forced to go back, and now she's cooperating with the defendant. And if the defendant knows that we don't get her served, then she's not going to be here. You know, the case is going to get dismissed. So before we hired Isaac to work with us, we had a very high dismissal rate on those cases. Mm. Once we got Isaac in place, that dismissal rate went down to nearly zero. Isaac gets these people served. Now, he does some investigations on his own, kind of, that's just the nature of the way he works. But usually one of my investigators will, or my lawyers will say, we know where this person is, here's the address, go-getter, and that's what happens. So yes, the bulk of the subpoenas we sent out, and if you imagine, most of them are to police officers, to cooperative witnesses throughout the city, and they'll just sign their waiver saying, I'm coming. Mm-hmm. And then that's enough to show the judge if the person doesn't show up. But for those that don't show up, we have to have a personally served subpoena. Isaac does that for us. Sometimes our investigators will, but the bulk of them are done by him. Then we can either put him on the witness stand, or we can show that he swears he served the person. Then we can ask for a warrant for their arrest, and they're put in jail for not coming to court. And we also can say, Judge, we need a couple of days, or we need a continuance, and then the case doesn't get dismissed. And in those critical cases where women are getting beaten, where the victim has stopped being cooperative, a sexual assault case where the victim may be a drug addict or something along those lines, we have to get them served, or the judges just say, well, do you have a subpoena to show me? And if not, I'm dismissing the case. That's what happens. And, you know, it's just not the right thing.
Right. And I imagine some of those doors you knock on, the people behind them aren't always happy to see you. Is it dangerous?
Well, now, you know, we may have to cut and say, due to the graphic nature of this topic, well, there are, you know, it's all relative. It's just different cases. People can be as violent on a criminal case mm-hmm. as on a collection case. And it's all in the matter of how you approach the door. And, you know, Mitch has seen me work for years. You know, I afford everybody common courtesy. I'm the most polite guy in the world. And sometimes you're not so polite. Sometimes you meet some people, like Mitch says, you have a victim who decided to reconcile with a boyfriend or husband or spouse who is abusing them. Then you have two hostile people at the door. But I afford everybody common courtesy. And then, you know, sometimes you have to go along with your gut feeling, okay, this isn't right here. You know, you have to have your sixth and seventh sense up, you know, watch your back, what's going on here, you know.
I want to ask you, what is meant by personal service?
Now, personal service means the paper, that the subpoena that's directed to Tamara Banks, I have to serve that person personally, and it usually it's on a matter as a subpoena with the DA's office. It has to be personal service. It says, no, I handed it to Tamara, and she was advised to go to court, and that's personal service, and on contempt citations. So mostly subpoenas, contempt citations, and restraining orders are usually require personal service.
And so then I'm sorry, Mitch, go ahead.
Well, there is also a process where the sheriffs are used to serve certain types of papers mm-hmm. from the city, from judges, contempt citations, those types of things. Unfortunately for us, we don't use that side of this. We can't use the sheriffs for that. The sheriffs really work for the court, or they work for the city. And there is a group of them that are out on the streets serving people all the time. But they're not like eviction notices and those kinds of things. That's what the sheriff's department does. So if someone gets served with an eviction, that's going to be from a Denver sheriff. But we don't do that. We have to use our own staff. We have to use either our investigators or Isaac. And we just don't have the investigative resources at the misdemeanor level. That's where we have the bulk of our cases. That's where we have a lot of domestic violence cases. They're more minor cases. The injuries aren't quite as great. But we only have two investigators for all those courtrooms, all those cases. They work closely with Isaac, but Isaac does, I would say, 98% of the services for all of those cases at the county court level that require personal service. District court level, we have a lot more investigators, and they actually serve a lot of subpoenas. But Isaac has really started to dovetail with them and work as a team. It took a little while for them to kind of build up the trust and to get to know Isaac. He immediately had an impact at the county court level. Juvenile court, district court came along, and now they rely on him not quite as much because they have more contact mm-hmm. with the victim throughout the case. Sometimes in our county court cases, we've never had contact with the victim. Isaac's the first person that contacts them, representing our office, serves those papers. They reluctantly come in or don't come in at all, and the next time we see them, they may very well be in jail.
And so does the state allow substitute service, and can you explain what that is?
The particularly for the DA's office, it's very rarely substitute service. So only circumstance, like Mitch was saying, on a juvenile case. Mm-hmm. So if there's a child who's a witness on the case or the victim, then you know you serve the parent as substitute service. But generally on criminal matters or matters like county and civil, you rarely do substitute service, especially if it's a subpoena. Now again, on the collection level, if it was on a collection agency action, or you know someone's being sued for a bill, you can substitute service on an individual by any member of the family over the age of 18 years old.
You know, on the civil side, you have agents that will accept service for companies. So for instance, if you have an out-of-state company, corporation, it's a Delaware corporation, they can't operate in Colorado unless they have a registered agent for service, so they can be sued. Banks oftentimes get served with garnishments and those kinds of things. So when I was in law school, I would get paid by the successful service. So I would go out, and I loved it when I went to a bank and I would serve like five or six garnishments on the same bank. I get paid for each one of them. So it was one trip. There's somebody sitting at the bank that just says, okay, takes the papers, and you know, that was great. For me, that was a good payday.
We call that the gravy serve, Mitch.
Yeah, it was a gravy serve. But you know, I had some difficult ones. You know, sometimes, and I know Isaac's done this, I got into a building one time that was a totally secure building, because I was kind of young looking. Always tried to dress nice enough that I wouldn't just get booted out immediately. And I ended up on this secure floor just because they followed people and got on the elevator. And, you know, the person came out that I needed. I gave it to them. And they said, well, how'd you get in here? I said, I don't know. Got back on the elevator and I was out of there as fast as I could move.
You sound like a reporter.
You know? So, yeah, it's a lot like that. And Isaac has that down. He's good. The concern we always have is that there might be somebody that would get violent with him. And he knows the backup plan there is to call the police if he needs them, or get our investigators to go with him. But you know, he's very smooth.
So how many cases do you serve, say, in a month, average?
It just kind of depends. You know, usually December kind of slows down because you don't like to do cases during Christmas time. Mm-hmm. Don't like to have trials during Christmas time. But
oh, right.
They've been pretty busy. It's just always a blur of how many I do.
Well, and he serves for the city, too. Remember, the city attorney has the same issue we have.
Right.
They got to have that personal service on the domestic violence victim, too. Mm-hmm. They handle the bulk of the domestic violence calls in the city of Denver. So we'll have 4,000 a year. Well, they get the bulk of them because they're a slapping or they're something like that. He's got to get those persons served, too. The other thing about Isaac, he is one of the best musicians in the state of Colorado.
So, well, I'm talking, making know, sense.
He has some other business. He has always busy man. That's the one thing I will say.
Tamara's seen me perform.
That's right. Jacquard is great. I love that band. We're going to go to break in just a second, but before we get to that, tell us a little bit about what does it take to become a process server? What's your background?
Well, I started in this business in 1978 working for a guy who showed me the ropes. And so I was looking for something because I played music and I thought, I need something I can do in the day or if I'm off even in the evenings. And I saw an ad for a process server for, it was then the largest process serving company in Colorado called Investigative Services. And it was half a block away from my apartment on Capitol Hill. So I walked over there and the guy said, well, I'm looking for experienced servers. I said, well, I don't have any experience, but I explained, I said, this seems perfect. I play music and I think I could do this in the day. He goes, well, I need an experienced guy. He says, but I'm going to hire you. I think you're going to do good in this business. So I worked for that guy from 78 till 80, and he showed me the ropes, you know, of how to do it. And then in 1980, I started my own company.
Wow.
So I've been a long time.
Well, I bet you have some amazing stories. We're going to take a break right now, and we'll be right back with more Dialogue Denver DA, and our guest is Isaac Points. We'll be right back. Well, Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. This is the portion of the show where we talk about a legal term. And today's legal term is probable cause versus proof beyond a reasonable doubt. And the definition is probable cause is a lower level of proof. It is sufficient reason to believe a crime has been committed. Proof beyond a reasonable doubt, a higher level of proof, is proof that leaves no reasonable doubt for a juror that a defendant is guilty. So basically, Mitch, there's just a different level of probability whether or not this person is guilty of the crime they're charged of.
Well, what we have is, you know, in the law there are three different levels of proof, and depending on what kind of case you're talking about. In the criminal area, there's really only two. That's probable cause, and probable cause is there's a reasonable belief that a crime occurred and this person committed it. It's a very low standard. It requires very little evidence. It's enough to go into a search warrant or an arrest warrant in order to get somebody in jail. It just has to be, you know, reasonable that a crime occurred and this person did it. Proof beyond a reasonable doubt, on the other hand, is the burden that we have for somebody to be found guilty in a criminal case. So we have to get 12 jurors to agree that this person is guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. And there's a very technical definition of reasonable doubt and what that means that we give to the jury. But really what it is, it's something that you wouldn't hesitate in a matter important to yourself. You know, is it the kind of doubt that you wouldn't act as a result of that doubt in something that's important? So I think that sometimes people don't realize our system is set up in a way that it is very, very hard, one, to meet that burden, and two, to meet it on maybe eight or maybe four or five different elements. Each one has to be proven beyond a reasonable doubt. And then when we have cases where there are defenses, like self-defense or in a police officer situation, justified homicide or one of those defenses are raised, we have to disprove the defense beyond a reasonable doubt. The defendant has no burden at any time in our system to prove anything. They raise a defense, we have to disprove it. We have to prove those elements, and we have to do that beyond a reasonable doubt. Highest standard in the law.
People have to recognize the difference between those two. It's quite unique.
It is.
Let's get back to our guest here, Isaac Points. Isaac, just before the break, we were talking about some of the dangers. Tell us some of the stories that you have been involved in and processing serving.
Well, one of the first serves I'd done in the years back in the 70s. I remember a little old lady, when it's just a minute, she comes back with a pot of boiling hot water to throw on me.
Oh my gosh. What was she wanted for? What did she have to do?
No, I was actually, you know, it was in a substitute service thing. You know, I was serving her for her daughter.
Wow.
And she lost it with me. It was like, wow. And
were you hurt?
Oh no, you know, I can run pretty fast. But, you know, on some cases, most of the scuffles I've been in are usually the people who have nothing to do with the case. I call them the pain in the behind, innocent bystanders, where they tell you, well, she doesn't have to take that, don't do this. But I'm like, well, what are you, a judge? You know, take this paper. Those are the people that usually have the problems with it. You know, you actually get in a scuffle or get in a fist fight with, and mm-hmm. I've had a lot of them through the years. You know, 2013, a guy pulled a shotgun out on me on a collection case.
Wow.
You know, yeah, crazy.
And what sorts of rules and laws are there in place to protect people like yourself?
Well, you know, actually there's no laws in place to protect process servers. I'm a board member of the Process Serving Association of Colorado PASCO. We're trying to get legislation done that protects process servers in the same capacity like a law enforcement officer or the sheriff is protected, because sometimes, you know, when the police are called in these situations, I had one where your father represented me in a case. I forgot about this years ago. I'm in my tennis whites. I'm trying to find this guy. Your dad had me track down a collection matter on a citation. Guy calls the Cherry Hills Village police on me. They had their shotguns on me. The guy's a burglar. I said, I'm wearing tennis whites. And the guy says, I want to have this guy arrested for breaking into my home. And it was a pretty nasty case. And Mitch's father wound up representing me on the case, which, of course, I walked on it. But, you know, too many times the server's kind of in a predicament when some of the officers show up. They side with the homeowner as opposed to the process server.
Really?
When, you know, at the PASCO meetings, we instruct the servers, you know, we are here on a legal matter, you know, which I explained on that situation. I'm here on a legal matter. I'm not here to cause trouble. But sometimes, you know, sometimes some officers don't take your side on a case like that.
You know, it is a concern that we have. And, you know, the legislature, it's really a shame because the legislature does afford police officers and certain law enforcement protection. So if you assault a police officer, it's a more serious misdemeanor. If it's third degree assault, it carries a mandatory jail sentence. If you hurt a police officer, it's a first degree assault with a weapon as opposed to just menacing a police officer. You don't even have to hurt him. You just point a gun at him. That's a class 3 felony. Last year in the legislature, we tried to provide for the same types of protections for paramedics and people that are first on the scene. Mm-hmm. It got through one house and died in the other. And it always dies because it has a fiscal impact. In other words, somebody's going to go to jail if you up the level of assault. If somebody assaults Isaac, then it's a third degree assault. If somebody punches him, say. If he's a process server with the kind of protections that a law enforcement person would have, then it's going to be a more serious crime. And I think those are the kind of protections that he and his folks are talking about. And, you know, I just think that based on my experience in trying to get that level changed in other professions that are part of first responders, part of the legal process, it's going to be hard to get that done in this state. It's a very difficult thing to do.
But it sounds like it's not that unusual to come upon a difficult, complicated situation you're serving. So out of 10 times, how many times do you...
Well, I have a rule of thumb. In my serving process, I always joke at the DA's office. I say, if I don't get cursed out once a day, I'm not doing my job. So I'm pretty thick-skinned. So I'll let people say anything. So I always say 1 in 10 are going to curse you out.
Yeah.
1 in 100 want to physically fight you. And 1 in 1,000 want to kill you. So where do you go with those odds you don't know? Like I said, I've been doing it so long, I really do have a sixth sense with this. You just kind of say, And, you know, Mitch knows what I'm talking about. You kind of say, something's not sitting right here. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to have to be a little bit more businesslike. Say, no, I need this person. We got a problem. Do we have to call the police? You know, I had one where a guy, I needed him. You guys need, the DA's office need him as a witness on the case. But he had a bench warrant out on him as well. And they said, well, as soon as you serve the guy, let us know so we can pick him up. So, I mean, the whole family's covering for the guy. I have a joke that a lot of those cases, when you knock on the door, the baby quits crying, the lights go out, the dog quits barking mid-bark. You know? And this guy, and I managed to get him. I hammered him, and I called Mitch's office and said, yeah, I just got him. So literally when I drove out, the police drove up to pick up the guy. Then what's funny, the next day I had to go back to get the mother's a witness. She goes, it's real weird. After you left, the cops came and got my boy.
How bad happened? And so how long does it take to serve? What's the longest time it's taken to serve someone? I mean, do you have like a statute of limitations that says you've got 2 weeks to get this guy or this woman, or how long does it?
Usually we have to get them within a certain period of time, especially if we're getting them from
Speedy
outside.
Mm-hmm.
If we get them from outside, we have to show that we provided bus fare for them to get to Denver. We have to pay for them to come and go. But most of our services that Isaac does are locally within Denver.
Yeah.
And within about 24 hours, if you show you got service within 24 hours of the hearing, might not always be a trial. It might just be a motions hearing or something.
Mm-hmm.
If you got service on them and the judges realize that, sometimes it can be 2 hours before. They understand that if the person is hiding,
right,
and Isaac gets them, and he might get them that morning for a 1:30 hearing, that's going to be good service if we can show that. Now, you know, they could come in and argue when the judge is going to put him in jail. Judge, you know, I was at work, and he gave me 5 minutes, and, you know, don't really put me in jail. But the thing about process serving is getting the person to court.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So if they're there in court saying, don't put me in jail, the judge might say, I'm not going this time, but now I don't need Isaac anymore.
Right.
Because now the person's standing in front of the judge, and the judge says, you will be back on this date. And if you don't come back, you are going to jail. And that's what people need to realize. When you get served with papers, or when you get a ticket that says you need to go to court, the downside of not following that court order is you are going to go to jail. And sometimes you might be getting on an airplane to go on a business trip, and somebody says, well, wait a minute, this guy's got a warrant for his arrest. I've seen guys go to jail out of the airport, and their whole family got on the plane, and they spent the vacation in jail because there was no one to bond them out. Mm-hmm. And that's why this show is important, because people got to realize these are legal court orders for you to be there. But the nice thing is when Isaac does get them, and we do get them into court, then from then on out, we can say, Judge, could you please tell the witness to come back? And once the judge orders them, it just has to be verbal. You'll be back on this date, or I'm going to hold you in contempt, put you in jail. Then we've got it. We've got it done.
Right.
And also on that timeline thing, they have a thing as speedy trial. Sometimes it's imperative they are served before the state, because the case may be kicked out because, you know, they, you know, used up the right to speedy trial.
Right.
But sometimes, you know, the DA's office, you know, there was a lady. The guys, she had several domestic violence through the years, and never would show.
Right.
And you know, some of those, I kind of like the real challenging ones. I said, we've been trying everything, and you know, we went to the ends of the earth, and she would just always disappear. Then someone found her on someone's job. Says, hey, we're proud, we just hired her. I went there and camped out of the apartment. And she looked at me and she just shook her head. She says, dude, you're good. I've been running for 2 years.
Oh my God. See, we're going to start a new show, and we're just going to call it Isaac's Process Serving Show, because we're out of time. We got to talk some more about this. This is really great. Thanks so much for being here.
Oh, thank you, Tamara.
It was so much fun talking with you. Thanks to Isaac Points for being our guest today with Denver DA Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll see you next time.
Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.